In this video, I'm going to talk about the octatomic scale from the point of view both of analysis, and particularly I'm going to have a little look at Debussy and Poulenc, both of whose pieces come up in the Educas A-level specification. I also want to think about it more generally from the point of view of how it has been used by composers, and therefore how you might use it in your own compositions. It's a brilliantly versatile scale. It's been used by composers regularly since Rimsky-Korsakov in the late 19th century, and even earlier than that arguably, and then into the early 20th century, lots and lots of composers use either the octatonic scale in its entirety or write music that is heavily inflected by the octatonic scale, has a sort of strong octatonic accent. So I really want to try and give you a flavour of that accent, the sort of octatonic sound, and explain a little bit about how it works. In order to talk intelligently about the octatonic scale, it's helpful to think about what we might say about an ordinary scale, like this D major scale that I've put up on the screen. One of the things we can talk about is the patterns, the melodic patterns within the scale. So we can see in a D major scale there's the obvious patterns of tone, tone, semitone, etc. And also we can see that the first four notes are the same pattern as the last four notes, and that those two repeating patterns are a fifth apart. And it's of course that allows a lot of music to be transposed from tonic to dominant. Finally, it's worth remarking upon the chords that you can get from this scale. So as we know, there's three major chords, 1, 4, and 5, three minor, 2, 3, and 6, and one diminished chord on chord 7. And that availability of chords, that suite of chords, gives tonal music, music in a major key, a very particular flavour and a very particular sort of functionality. So let's look in the same way at the D octatonic scale. Let's hear it first. It's 8 notes rather than 7. That's why it's called octatonic. And the pattern is actually a much more regular and symmetrical one than the major scale. It starts off with a tone, followed by a semitone, then a tone, semitone, alternating all the way up to the top of the scale. As with the D major scale, there are patterns in the octatonic scale that repeat. So we have the first four notes of a D minor scale at the beginning, and the top half of the scale is the first four notes of an A flat minor scale. And there are in fact two more minor scales as well, an F minor scale, and also not shown on here, C flat minor or B minor scale. So there's plenty that's familiar in this octatonic scale, these four note minor scale segments, but the way in which they relate is less familiar. In the major scale we looked at, the repeated segments, the first four notes of the major scale, was related by a fifth, so we get that tonic and dominant relationship. Here though, the main relationship is between D and A flat, which is a tritone, a diminished fifth apart, which makes for a much more unusual relationship. And in fact, we get the same relationship between F and C flat, and the whole set of them are related by minor thirds. I think it's this mixture of the familiar, the minor scale segments, and the unfamiliar, the tritonal relationships, that make this scale so appealing to early 20th century composers. And another way of looking at this scale explains this essentially this same phenomenon in a different way. So you can understand the octatonic scale as two overlapping sets of diminished seventh chords, which is why it's sometimes called the diminished scale. So you can see there is a D diminished chord, D, F, A flat, and C flat, shown by the top bracket, and interlocking with it, an E diminished seventh chord, an E, G, B flat, D flat chord. So the two parts of the scale divided up that way sound like this. This diminished seventh construction potentially makes any music based on this scale very unstable, and that's certainly something that composers increasingly became interested in. So we've looked at some of the familiar and unfamiliar scalic patterns in this scale. Now I want us to look at the chords that we can find. So you can see from this slide here that there are plenty of familiar functional chords available in the octatonic scale. So if you look at the E, for example, the second note of the scale, using notes from the scale, you can build an E major chord, an E minor chord, and an E dominant seventh chord. And you can build that set of chords on every other note of the octatonic scale. But you can't build stable major and minor chords on the other notes. So you can see that they go along with the E diminished seventh chord, but you can't do them on the D diminished seventh chord. So the resulting chords sound like this. What's really interesting about this is that we've got these stable, familiar chords that could be quite functional, particularly the dominant seventh chords, but because of where they appear in the scale along this diminished seventh, so either a minor third or a tritone apart, a diminished fifth apart, they can't ever function in a normal tonal way with each other. You can't get that tonic dominant perfect fifth or tonic subdominant perfect fourth relationship going. So we've got the familiar chords related in a very unfamiliar way. So if you hear the dominant seventh chords played one after the other, you can hear it's a very particular flavour with the more minor third apart and not able to resolve. So we've got the familiar minor scale segments, and we've got some familiar chords, major, minor, and dominant seventh, but the way in which they are related makes their appearance in any piece of music based on this scale sound more exotic and unfamiliar than you might otherwise expect. So I want to give you a flavour of how that comes out in some actual pieces of music. One thing to listen out for in octatonic music are those tritone related chords. So you can see in this C sharp octatonic scale, two of the chords are available, F sharp major and C major, which together give this sort of sound. Those two chords are famously used together in Stravinsky's Petrushka, but you more often come across them producing a sort of heavily inflected dominant, so it sounds like this. You can hear this sort of octatonic dominant in use in Poulenc's trio for piano, oboe, and bassoon. And in bar 34 here, just before figure 5, he prepares this triple forte arrival in B major with this F sharp plus C major chord, which sounds like a very, very spicy added note dominant. So here it is, starting the bar before in bar 33. So that's one really common octatonic hallmark, that sort of octatonically flavoured dominant here, an F sharp dominant seventh with all those C major chords spicing it up. Another octatonic hallmark or fingerprint to listen out for is another tritone related one, and that is scales that have a prominently raised fourth, a bit like in the Lydian mode. And you can hear that really famously in the theme tune to The Simpsons by Danny Elfman. What gives it its octatonic flavouring is that basically D flat tonality with that really prominent G in the third note of the tune there. And Elfman keeps on emphasising that tritone relationship. You can see in the third bar there, and also at the end, as you can hear in this little example. Just as an aside, this isn't the only way of understanding this little theme. In fact, it can be also understood as a D flat, what's called acoustic scale, and I'll just show you the two scales next to each other. You can see what these two scales have in common is the augmented fourth and the flat seventh. And in fact, the only way in which they differ is that the second and third note of the octatonic scale is rather simpler in the D flat acoustic scale. Instead of that, you just have the first three notes of a major scale, so the D and the E are replaced by an E flat. But the point is that this augmented fourth and flat seventh inflection, this sort of accent, is one that's very commonly found in octatonic music, and that Simpsons example is one you'll be very familiar with. And all the notes that are in the example I played you could come from either one of those two scales. Another great example of a piece with this sort of fairly general octatonic flavouring, these tritone and minor third related chords, is Stravinsky's very early Scherzo Fantastique. And here you get a whirling series of dominant seventh chords that are related along a diminished seventh chord, just as they are in the octatonic scale. Very much a trick that Stravinsky borrows off Rimsky-Korsakov. And a composer friend of mine, Ian Stevens, calls this effect octastic, which I think is an excellent way of describing it. Octastic indeed, that really sort of glittering sound is being brought about by those octatonic flavourings. I want to turn now to some slightly more hardcore examples of octatonicism, if you like, where the octatonic collection is not just adding some flavouring and some spice, but actually really providing the fundamental basis for the way that the tonality of the music is organised. And this tends to create a slightly more mysterious sort of effect rather than just this sort of glittering addition to the harmony that we hear there in the Stravinsky and in the Poulenc octatonically inflected dominant that we just heard before that. We're going to hear next from a composer I've mentioned a couple of times already and who precedes both Stravinsky and Poulenc and was considerable inspiration to a lot of early 20th century composers, and that's Rimsky-Korsakov. In one of the scenes from his opera Sadko, we visit the invisible city of Kitesh, a mysterious city that appears from beneath the water. And Rimsky-Korsakov portrays this mysterious city with a very heavily octatonic series of chords, almost a demonstration of the octatonic relationships, as you can see in the score. As the city appears in the depths of the lake, these octatonic harmonies also appear out of the depths. So we start off in the orchestra, you can see it in the piano reduction here, with a low rumbling E, and then a C major chord appears over that, and the bass continues to rise through a diminished seventh chord, E, G, B flat. Then when it changes to C sharp at the beginning of the next line, the harmony changes to F sharp major chord, and the rise continues, and then we're back to a C major chord, and then back to an F sharp major chord. So we've got this highly octatonic series of chords creating a very mysterious effect, as you can hear. With most of the examples so far, the possible exception being the Simpsons theme tune, the octatonic scale has mostly affected the harmony in the music that I've played. In this next example by Béla Bartók, the use of the scale is primarily melodic, and it's extremely uncompromising. It's really a sort of study in the octatonic melodic relationships. So you can see here what Bartók has done in this violin duet, which is called Harvest Song. The top violin, the first violin, is playing the upper four notes of the D sharp octatonic scale, so that's an A minor segment, and the lower part, with a different key signature even, is playing the bottom half of the octatonic scale, so that's a D sharp minor segment, and the sound of the two overlaid is really very strange. So Bartók's really thinking of the lines here, and then the way in which they interact sort of arises from the combination of those lines. It's a technique you could very well use in your own compositions, trying various segments of the octatonic scale against each other. I'm just going to play you one more example, which is the next few bars, in fact, where Bartók uses imitation to counterpoint two segments from an octatonic scale, a different one on this occasion. We're going to finish by listening to a couple of excerpts from Debussy's Nuages, from his three nocturnes. This is a piece which uses octatonic scales quite heavily, particularly in the Y material. So Stravinsky's alternating X and Y material, and it's the second of the two sort of segments that he repeats that is particularly octatonic, and it's based on the B octatonic scale. There are actually only three octatonic scales, but you can start them on any note, and this one makes sense to talk about it starting on B, because that's the note that's most emphasized. So this is bar 5 of the piece in piano score, just to make it a bit easier to see. And the extract is exclusively octatonic. It's all taken from the same B octatonic scale. and you can hear it gives it a very particular flavour, both melodically and harmonically. So first of all, we get a sort of G7 harmony in the first four bars of this little extract, and then it shifts just one of those notes to a G sharp, giving us a chord progression that we can't really get in diatonic major minor music. So that's one sort of strongly octatonic harmonic flavour. And then the melody, which you can see, which is played by the cor anglais, spans a tritone, again a very much a familiar interval from the octatonic scale, from F down to B. That haunting cor anglais melody comes back many times in the piece, and one of those times is at bar 80 here, where the upbeat you can't see is just before. And in a very typically impressionist way, remember, impressionist composers are interested in colour and atmosphere, he presents the melody exactly the same pretty much, although he repeats it, but the octatonic harmonies around it, the colours, are changed. So rather than just a G7 chord, he changes to a different dominant seventh chord, a C sharp dominant seventh chord, in bar 82 and 3 there, in the third and fourth bars of the top system, and then going down onto the next system, in bars 86 and 87, we move to an E major chord, E major dominant seventh chord. So we've had three dominant seventh chords, very typical of octatonic harmony and related along that diminished seventh axis, as we've seen. So here is the same material presented with a different cloudy colouring. Let's listen to the very end of the piece to finish off with, where we get the music fading out in a very sort of unclear, unstable tonality. We're on B, which is pretty much the tonality in which we started, but very much not B minor or B major. We've still got the G7 chord hanging on just about, and some tritones in there, and it's sort of like an octatonic fog that the piece disappears into at the end.